So in this video, we'll finish up our study of abstract probability theory. And then in the next one, I'll talk about operators in quantum mechanics, where they come from, why we think that they should be there. Okay, so that'll get us back into physics, and then we'll continue on from there. All right, so let me start by just clarifying something from the last video that I didn't do a particularly good job of explaining. In fact, I didn't really explain it at all. And that is the following thing. I claim that if I have a continuous random variable, let's call it x hat, with a density little f, okay, by which I mean an integration density, the way we usually work with. So little f, right, is the integration density. Then the mere finiteness, or the, let's call it the convergence more technically. And I'll even say this, the mere convergence, by which I mean this is all you have to look at, okay, of the improper integral of x f of x over the entire real line is actually sufficient to imply the tightness of the CDF of this random variable, let's call it big F. And remember that big F is just the integral of little f up to x, starting at minus infinity. Okay, so just the fact that this integral here of x times f of x over the entire real line converges. Now, I have to remind you what convergence means for a doubly improper integral. So this is not a principal value. This is an improper integral. And remember that the definition of that is that it's the integral from negative infinity to zero plus the integral from zero to positive infinity, provided both are finite. Okay? Both of them have to be finite for this improper integral to exist, to converge. So, but if I assume that it does converge in the sense that both of these separate integrals are finite, let's assume that. Okay, then that turns out to be sufficient to imply that capital F of x is a tight function. Okay, and remember what tight means. I.e., it just means that if I look at the product x times 1 minus capital F of x, that goes to 0 as x goes to plus infinity. And also, x times big F of x will go to 0 as well as x goes to minus infinity. So those two things together comprise the property of tightness. Okay, and therefore, remember that when we have tightness, we also have the fact that the expected value, if it exists at all, is given by this integral. Okay, so let me write this out very carefully. If x hat is expectable, then because it's also tight, then we can conclude that the expected value is given by that integral. Because that's the formula we proved under the assumption that this continuous random variable was both expectable and tight. But you see, we get tightness for free. The tightness is something that just follows from the convergence of this doubly improper integral. So as long as we have the convergence, as long as we know the convergence of this doubly improper integral, then all we need is the expectability. And that's sufficient to say that the expected value is actually given by this formula. We don't need to explicitly check the tightness, because the tightness is something that follows basically for free. Okay, but actually, you see, the situation is even better than that, because we don't even need to assume that x hat is expectable. Okay, so, yes, the situation is even better, because actually it just follows from the finiteness or convergence of this improper integral that actually x hat must be expectable. We can conclude for certain, we don't need to assume that x hat is expectable, we can actually conclude that. And then we can also conclude that this formula for the expected value is true. Okay, so you see that in the end, in practical work, we usually only know a random variable through its density. Suppose I have some continuous random variable x hat. I usually won't have a formula for x hat, or a formula for its CDF even. I usually just have an explicit formula for its density. That's the way we usually work with continuous random variables. And you've already seen that amply in our course so far, where, for example, in quantum mechanics, we have the wave function psi, which is a complex value function, and when we took the mod square of that, we got a density for a certain random variable, which we interpreted as the position of the particle, when the particle was in the state psi. So it's a random variable that depends on psi, but we know it only through its density. We don't really know the random variable itself, but we do know the density of it. Okay, so that's the typical situation where I really only know the density. So how am I going to decide if the random variable is expectable at all? Like, forget about computing its expected value. How do I even know that it is expectable, that it has an expected value? Okay, well, this claim that I'm making here is the answer to that. All you have to do is check that this integral converges. If this integral converges, then you can say that the random variable x hat is indeed expectable. And you can also say that that integral gives the expected value. Everything else disappears into the background. The CDF totally disappears. We don't need it. Once we prove this claim, we don't need to check that the CDF is tight because it is automatically. Right, so everything flows from just the convergence of this improper integral here. Okay? It gives us everything else we want. It gives the expectability of the random variable, and it also gives the formula for the expected value, which is the formula that we're used to, the integral of x times f of x over the entire real line. Okay, so how do I know that these claims are correct? So let me show you. First, I'm going to show you how we know that capital F is tight. This stuff here we can just ignore, because that was just incidental. Okay, so remember we're assuming the convergence of the improper integral, which means in more detail we're assuming the convergence of this single improper integral. And let me just call its value capital A temporarily, so that's some finite real number. And then, of course, we have the other one from minus infinity to zero. Same integrand. And let me call this one capital B, also some finite real number. So those are the things basically that I'm assuming. Okay, now let's focus on this one. And just recalling the definition of a single improper integral, what this really means is that if we integrate from zero up to A, that same integrand, x times f of x, then this will approach the value capital A, as little a goes to positive infinity. And so as this upper limit of integration gets larger and larger, this whole quantity approaches a limit, and that limit is the definition of this improper integral, which we just called A, by definition. Okay, so we can interpret it this way. Okay, and now let's consider the following quantity, right? I'm going to consider the quantity A times 1 minus f of A. And the first thing to notice is that it's non-negative. This is when A is positive. So let's let A be positive without loss of generality. W log stands for without loss of generality. Okay, the reason it's no loss of generality is because the whole point of this is to let little a go to infinity. So as it does so, it will eventually become positive and stay positive from that point on. So we may as well just restrict to positive values of little a. There's no loss of generality in that. Okay, so this factor here is positive for that reason. And then this factor here is non-negative simply because every CDF has values between 0 and 1. So in particular, 1 minus f of x is always non-negative for all x. Okay, particularly when you plug in x equals a, you get that fact. Okay, so you have a strictly positive factor a times a non-negative factor. And so yes, that quantity is non-negative. Okay, on the other hand, we can also write this in this way. Actually, let me just use x as an integration variable. Okay, and here what I'm doing is I'm just simply using the fact that this, when you integrate the density from minus infinity up to a, it just gives you an alternative expression for capital F of a. That's the relationship between the CDF and the integration density. The relationship is, in general, the CDF is just the integral of the integration density from minus infinity up to x. Okay, something like that. Okay, so anyway, we're up to whatever point you're looking at. In our case, it's a. So this is the CDF at a. Okay, anyway, so now, go back to the calculation. All right, and the crucial observation here is to realize that this 1 can also be thought of as an integral of f of little x, namely from minus infinity to plus infinity. Because remember that every integration density has that property, that this improper integral exists and is equal to 1. So it's like a totally integrable function. And the other properties it has to have are being non-negative everywhere, and also being piecewise continuous. The reason we need piecewise continuity is just to make sure that the Riemann integral exists. So we can only allow, let's say, a discrete set of discontinuity points. Some discrete set where little f has discontinuity points is fine. That doesn't affect the existence of the Riemann integral. Okay, but yeah, the fact that the total integral exists and is equal to 1 is one of the key properties of an integration density. Okay, these being the other key properties. So by treating that 1 in that way, you see that we basically have a difference here. This subtraction is a difference between two improper integrals of little f of x, one of which goes from negative infinity to plus infinity, the other of which goes from negative infinity to a. So when you subtract those two, what you're left with is... Okay, let me just copy these things down. And what you're left with is, I have an a outside, and then I'll have the integral from a to plus infinity here. Okay. Now, let me just take a minute just to, as a little aside, kind of formally back up that claim. What I'm claiming here is that this integral minus this one can be written this way. But we have to remember that this is not completely obvious, simply because this one has a definition. And by definition, it's minus infinity to zero, right? Plus zero to infinity. But actually, the split point that we use doesn't have to be zero, but that's the most symmetrical point to use. Okay, and then we have this other thing we're subtracting off. But you see, that other thing we're subtracting off can also be broken up into the following thing. You can say, stop the integration at zero, and then go on from zero to a. This is if a is positive. Let me assume that, because that assumption is in effect here anyway. I'm already assuming here that a is positive, so I may as well, in my little aside, also assume a is positive. Okay, now actually, the same claim, the same equation that we're trying to prove right now is true even if a is negative. The proof is just slightly different, but I'll just illustrate the idea of the proof in the case when a happens to be positive. Okay, so because a is positive, the integral from minus infinity to a can be broken up as the integral from negative infinity to zero, and then the integral from zero to a, the sum of those two. All right, well, now you see what's going to happen is that this minus sign distributes, and this term here is going to cancel with this term. So all that remains is 0 to plus infinity, and then also with a minus sign, 0 to a. Okay, now, not quite done yet, but it's pretty easy from here. Okay, from here what we would do is we would say, this is like the limit of the integral from 0 to, let's say, b, as b goes to plus infinity. And then this doesn't involve b. This term is independent of b. So we can absorb that into the limit sign. And write it like this, integral from 0 to b minus integral from 0 to a. Now, we can take b to be greater than a without loss of generality, because b is on its way to plus infinity. And so then, assuming that b is greater than a, we can combine those two integrals this way. That's a familiar fact about integrals on finite intervals, bounded intervals. If I go from 0 to b, and I subtract from that this piece from 0 to a, all that's left over is the piece from a to b. Okay. So yeah, and then because we're taking the limit as b goes to infinity, that's by definition, integral from a to plus infinity, which is exactly the thing we wanted. So, okay, it's a little bit of a messy proof, but it's a rigorous proof, if you felt that one was needed. Okay, so anyway, we have this quantity here, right here. And we can upper bound that one further in the following way. Let me just copy some things. So remember, I have this from a to plus infinity, and I have the factor of a outside. Now, the way we upper bound this is very clever. We're going to push the a factor inside the integral, which obviously is correct. But then I'm going to say the following thing. This integrand here is less than or equal to x times f of x when x is greater than or equal to a, which is exactly the range of integration. You see, x is running from a to infinity. So that's what x is doing. It's starting at a and going to plus infinity. So indeed, this inequality is true. And notice that they're both positive as well, because a is already assumed to be positive. And then f of x is non-negative. Let's remind ourselves that an integration density is non-negative everywhere. So therefore, we can multiply our inequality on both sides by f of x, and we get another true inequality. Okay, and now, when I have two integrands, where one of them is always greater than or equal to the other, on the range of integration, in other words, on the interval of integration, I have basically two functions, one of which is always greater than or equal to the other. So the integral of the greater function is going to be an upper bound. The integral of this greater function is going to be an upper bound for the integral of the smaller function. Okay? And I know that this upper bound is finite. That's an important fact, because remember that the integral from 0 to plus infinity of x f of x is already known to be finite. It's a. And then if I just subtract away from that, the integral from 0 to a. In fact, let's write it that way. We can write this answer as the integral from 0 to infinity minus the integral from 0 to a. In other words, capital A minus the integral from 0 to a of x f of x. And now notice that if we now let capital A get larger and larger to plus infinity, this goes to 0, right? Simply because of this. Right? This integral from 0 up to a, if you let a get larger and larger and larger, that integral will approach capital A. So the difference, capital A minus that very same integral, right? That's what I have here, capital A, and then I'm subtracting that very same integral. So that difference is going to 0. So look what we have now. This quantity here is trapped between 0 on one side and then some upper bound that's decaying to 0 on the other side. So the squeeze theorem applies. And the squeeze theorem is going to tell us that this quantity here is going to go to 0 as a gets larger and larger. But that's exactly what tightness requires, at least at plus infinity. Okay? So we have the tightness, this verifies the tightness of capital F at plus infinity. Okay? And then we also have to verify the tightness at minus infinity. And I'm just going to leave that as an exercise. Okay, so you should try this. You know, pause the video now or come back to this later. But definitely try to apply the same methods and prove or show that we also have the tightness property of capital F at negative infinity. In other words, what you have to show is this. If you take the product A times F of A, as A goes to minus infinity, and you can assume that it's negative, you know, without loss of generality. Okay. Anyway, as you let A get larger and larger negative, this thing should go to 0. So again, what you're going to try to do is, you know, get some bounds. Like, an upper bound will be 0, because notice that this A is negative by our assumption without loss of generality. And F of A is non-negative, since every CDF is non-negative everywhere. In fact, it's between 0 and 1 everywhere. So you have a strictly negative number times a non-negative number, and that's certainly less than or equal to 0. And then you're going to try to find a lower bound. You're going to want to try to prove that this lower bound also goes to 0 as a goes to minus infinity. And then the squeeze theorem is going to take over and tell you that this quantity is squeezed also towards 0, right, which will verify this claim. So actually, we have tightness automatically. Right, and then the one other thing I want you to remember, this is from a previous video, actually the last video, the very last one that I posted, was that at the end of the day, what we ended up with was something like this. We ended up with the expected value of x hat. Well, it was actually just the positive part that we were computing, which, remember, I defined by way of the magic formula as this integral. And I'll remind you also that the negative part in general can be defined as the other integral, including the minus sign, the other term in the magic formula. So those are what I dubbed the positive part and the negative part. And those both have to be finite in order for x hat to be considered expectable. Right? And then the expected value of x is just the sum of those two, by definition, provided both terms are finite. Okay, anyway, so under the assumption that x hat is continuous, remember, we're now assuming everywhere throughout this entire video. Oh, well, sorry, that's a little bit exaggerated. Not this entire video, but certainly throughout the last video, we're always assuming that x hat was continuous. And we're still assuming that x hat is continuous throughout this entire discussion. Okay, later on in this video, we'll talk about other more general situations. Okay, but anyway, we were working on this integral, this one here, using the fact that big f of x could be expressed as the integral from minus infinity to 0 of little f plus the integral from 0 to a of little f. This is where, again, I'm assuming that a is positive. Because let's assume this. Yeah, because the two of these terms together give the integral from negative infinity to a, which is, again, the fundamental relationship between the integration density and the CDF. Right? And then this term here was just a constant. It's independent of a. And it ended up kind of dropping out. It ended up kind of canceling out with some other term. So what we boiled it down to was something like this. It was like, there was this term, a times 1 minus f of a. Oh, sorry, of course there's a limit sign. As a goes to plus infinity. And then you had this term, and then the rest of it was just this term, integral from 0 to a of like x f of x. I think I wrote it as u f of u last time, du, but the name of the dummy variable doesn't make any difference. I'll just write it as x f of x dx. Okay, so this whole thing, we have to take a limit. Right? Now, notice that we just proved the tightness property under the assumption, again, that the... let me give this integral a name, because I keep on having to refer to it. So let me just give this integral here a name. This, call it capital I. So the assumption, remember, the global assumption that we're making throughout this whole topic right now, this claim and its proof, is that, first of all, x hat is continuous, and it has an integration density of f, and then also this I is a convergent, this capital I is a convergent, doubly improper integral. So, coming back here, we proved that under that assumption, we have the tightness property, which means that this term has a limit of zero. Right? As a goes to plus infinity, that term goes off to zero. So we can safely drop that term, and we can write the answer in the following way. This comes out to the limit as a goes to plus infinity of this integral. Right? And you see that limit is just an improper integral, like a singly x f of x. That's just a singly improper integral with infinity as the upper limit. Okay? Now let's be very, very, very careful here. I am not assuming that this is finite right now. It's still a question whether this is finite, because the other thing it could be is plus infinity. We don't know that yet. Same with this. This could either be finite and non-negative, or it could be plus infinity. We just don't know yet. But one thing we do know is that whether it's finite or not, we can express it as this limit here. And we also know that because this term goes to zero, it's correct to drop that term from that limit sign and just express the answer, which is this thing here, which again, we don't know. Either it's finite or perhaps it's plus infinity. We just don't know yet. But it's still correct to express that as the limit of this second term, as a goes to plus infinity. But you see, and that limit is indeed this improper integral just by definition, but this we do know is finite. Okay, we do know that this is finite because remember, that's part of the integral capital I. Our main assumption is that the integral capital I is convergent, which means in particular that this part of it, the part that integrates from zero to plus infinity, is finite. And that's exactly that part that we're looking at right now, over here. This is just the part of that integral from zero to plus infinity. So we do indeed know that that's finite. So you see that one side of the equation comes out finite, and that means that the other side is necessarily finite. Obviously, this thing here can't be plus infinity while the other side of the equation is finite. So you see that actually the finiteness of the positive part of the expected value follows as a theorem, based on our assumption that the capital I integral converges. This alternative is the only sensible one, the only consistent one. Must be finite. Okay? And then, of course, the same argument is going to work with the other term. This thing also could be either finite and negative, like less than or equal to zero, or it could come out to minus infinity. But the only one of those options that's going to be consistent with the convergence of capital I is the option where it's finite. So yeah, both of them are going to be finite, and therefore x hat is indeed expectable. Okay? And then also notice that since the positive part comes out to be this integral of x f of x, and since the negative part comes out to be this integral, also of x f of x, I'll leave you to check that. This claim here I haven't explicitly checked, but I'll just leave you to check the details on that. You're going to do it by starting with the same type of calculation that we looked at right here from the last video. And using tightness, you're going to be able to drop one of the two terms, the first term. So the same type of argument will apply. Okay, and not only are these both finite now, which means that x hat is expectable as a conclusion, but also we can make another conclusion, which is that the expected value of x hat is just the sum of the two. Right? And it's clear what the sum of those two is. It's just the full improper integral of x f of x. So see, the beauty of this observation is that we don't need to know anything but the density. We don't need to know or compute x hat as a function, like as a function from this open interval into the reals, or we don't even need big F, the CDF, as a function on the reals. We only need the density, little f. Right? We have to know that function. And this goes into like the non-negative reals. Okay, to decide whether or not x hat is expectable, and to calculate or compute the expected value of x hat. Namely, we just look at the integral of x f of x dx on the entire real line, and if it's finite, then we know that x hat is expectable, if it converges. Okay, and then thirdly, and finally, we just say that the thing we calculated already, this same doubly improper integral, is the expected value. Great, so that's a very, very important point I wanted to go over about continuous random variables. All right, good. So now the thing I want to move on to is talking about random variables that are defined as functions of other random variables. And these are not necessarily continuous. This is a more general piece of theory. But the main interest of this for us is the continuous case. And we're going to prove a special fact in the continuous case. We're going to show that in the continuous case, when you have a density, basically if I want the expected value of some function of x hat, as long as it's a reasonably simple function, and I'll be more precise about that in a few minutes, all you need is the original density of x hat itself. Instead of multiplying by x and then computing this doubly improper integral, you would just multiply by 5x. See, it's a beautiful formula. It's really nice because it means that the details of this random variable here, which we can also call y hat, are totally unimportant. By details, I mean like its CDF or its density, if it has a density, totally irrelevant. We don't need any of that. All we need to know is that function, 5x, and then just know the density of x hat itself. Nothing to do with phi. Take the product of the two and integrate it. And if that's finite, yeah, that's an important caveat. if that integral comes out finite, then it will follow that y hat is expectable, and that the expected value of y hat is given by that integral. So again, it's like not just that we can compute it, we can also know for sure that it represents the expected value. Because as long as that integral is finite, it turns out that y hat is indeed expectable, and its expected value is given by that integral. See, the danger is maybe the integral converges, but it doesn't represent expected value. But no, that can't happen. If the integral converges at all, it does represent the expected value of y hat. Yeah, but this only works when you have a density, meaning the x hat, the original x hat, has to be continuous. So you see that there is some special thing that happens in the continuous case. And there's a very similar theorem for the discrete case. That's usually true, is that any special formulas like this one that are particularly simple usually only work for discrete and continuous. Those are like two ends of an extreme. But there are many, many other random variables on the spectrum of possibilities between discrete and continuous, sort of mixtures of discrete and continuous. And for those, there aren't such nice formulas. Generally speaking, that's a truism of probability theory. So yes, there are nice formulas for discrete ones as well. Essentially, if x hat is discrete instead of continuous, then you're going to basically have the same formula, except you're going to just be plugging in the special points of positive mass and multiplying by the probability mass function, and then summing. So yeah, this is like the summation density instead of the integration density. And as long as that sum comes out finite, then it will represent the expected value of phi of x hat. This is when x hat has a summation density. In other words, when it's discrete. Okay, now I'm not going to bother proving this one. I'm going to leave this one as an exercise. Later I'll formally state this exercise. But you can apply the same kinds of ideas, as you'll see when we prove this one. But it's even easier because it's not integrals, it's just sums. So you'll basically try to prove that for yourself. But so you'll see that there's like a continuous formula and there's a discrete formula, and they're closely analogous to each other. You see that like the density and the differential kind of play the role of the probability mass function. The integral sign plays the role of the summation sign. And then you have the function phi of x, right, somewhere in the middle. So there's a nice analogy between the two, and that's also usually true. Special formulas that apply for discrete and continuous random variables usually have this analogy between them, where if you just replace summations with integrations, you get the right formula. You know, that's just a mnemonic. It doesn't count as rigorous mathematics. But it's a good mnemonic, it's generally quite reliable. Okay, so anyway, let me start out by just telling you what class of functions I'm going to restrict our attention to. And it's important to understand that these theorems hold for more general functions than what I'm about to say. But the more general the functions you allow yourself to use, the harder it is generally to prove the theorem. If you want to try to prove that something works for a very broad class, you have to use extremely deep techniques. Whereas if I have this more specialized assumptions that I can use, then I can try to use some kind of more elementary, superficial techniques. And that's what I want to do here. I want to get functions which are general enough for our purposes, but, you know, functions we can really get a hold on, have some concrete knowledge about. Okay, so this is the class of functions I'm going to restrict our attention to right now. So first of all, it has to go from the reals to the reals. So the domain is like all reals. Secondly, it's continuous. Everywhere. No discontinuity points at all. Okay, and then thirdly, this is probably best drawn out in a picture rather than written out in text. But the idea is that there's a finite number of points on the real line, and I'm going to label those as like A1, A2, A3, and so on, kind of left to right, up to, let's say, A capital N. Now, okay, perhaps this is not the best notation, because I don't want you to confuse these with the jump discontinuity points of capital F, which is the CDF of a given random variable. I already used the notation, like A sub N, to mean the jump discontinuities of that, so maybe I'll just change my notation. So we're going to call them like C1. Okay, so I have like this finite collection of points. Notice they're labeled in increasing order. And I'm also going to reserve the label C0 for minus infinity. So view that as being all the way at this end. And I'll reserve the label Cn plus 1 for plus infinity, which we think of as being all the way at the other end. So I want to like explicitly include those points in these inequalities. Like that. All right, and then on each interval between consecutive points in this list, the function phi, when you restrict to that interval, is going to be either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. Okay, so, for example, it could look something like this. Let's say on this first interval from C0 to C1, the function is strictly decreasing. And, you know, it can maybe like its tangent line could go flat at the endpoint, could have a local minimum. But it doesn't have to. Okay, on the next interval from C1 to C2, the function will be strictly increasing. Notice that these are filled in circles because it's a continuous function. There's no discontinuity points at all. Right, in the next interval, C2 to C3, we'll have a strict decrease again. Maybe it like crosses through the x-axis, perhaps, can have roots. Then I go from C3 to C4, let's say I'll have the function increasing again. Notice that you can have a cusp, like this point here is a cusp. It doesn't have to have a derivative at that point. In fact, I'm not really assuming differentiability of this function anywhere, but I'm going to want to assume differentiability later. So I'm going to make that part of my description of this class, is that this function is going to be assumed to be differentiable everywhere, except at these joining points. Like, there could be a derivative there just doesn't have to be. Like here, there could be a derivative, it would have to be zero, if it exists at all. But you see here, there's no derivative, because there's no unique tangent line. So we can allow the derivative to fail to exist at those joining points. But it could exist, it just doesn't have to. Okay, so you see that it alternates. You have these like red sections where it's decreasing, and then you have these green sections where it's increasing. And it just alternates back and forth between the two. Okay, and then in the last interval, and this could be like a red one or a green one, depending on whether n is even or odd. But if it's a red one, then it would be decreasing. So maybe it like starts here and it decreases. Okay, now also you should notice that if it's decreasing, sorry, I guess I erased some of that by accident. If it's decreasing, let me just start it up here. So it would have like an increasing section coming up here. And now maybe it's decreasing. It can do two things. It can either decrease to minus infinity, meaning it's getting like arbitrarily low in height, Or what could happen, alternatively, is that it might decrease toward an asymptote, let's say the x-axis. Of course, it doesn't have to be the x-axis, but it might do that. It might still be decreasing, but asymptotic to some horizontal line. So those are just two alternative behaviors that we could have. And the same is true at the other end. Like at the other end, there could also be a horizontal asymptote from which it is decreasing. So again, there are two alternative behaviors that are possible at each of the two ends. But those only affect the ends. Those only affect these like two particular intervals at the very ends. Okay, and so I'm also assuming here that phi is differentiable. In fact, I'm going to say even stronger, C1, continuously differentiable, just to make things nice and simple. See, all of the functions we're ever going to use as the phi are going to be extremely simple functions, like phi of x equals x squared, which easily satisfy all of these requirements. Like, they pass all these tests with flying colors. Not only is it C1, it's actually C infinity everywhere. So, you know, there's really no serious loss of generality if I assume that phi is a reasonably nice function. So let's just assume it's C1, except at the points, you know, C1, C2, up to CN, except possibly at those points. It's okay if it is still C1 at those points, just it doesn't have to be. So except possibly at C1, C2, up to CN. Okay, and then also one more thing is that the derivative of phi is either strictly increasing on each of these intervals, each of these open intervals from, let's say, CN to CN plus 1, or strictly... Okay, I think I said something wrong. I said strictly increasing. I meant strictly positive. The derivative is strictly positive. That means the function phi is strictly increasing. Okay, or the derivative is strictly negative, again, on the open interval, for each n. So on each of these intervals, but only on the open intervals. We don't really care what happens at the endpoints themselves, at those joining points. The derivative could be zero. Like, in this case, it is. Like, the derivative exists there and has the value zero because the tangent line is horizontal. So, but because that's happening at C1, we don't care. It's just in the interiors of all of these little intervals. We want the derivative to be either strictly positive or strictly negative. Okay. So let's take a look at an example. Like, main example for us, because this comes up with a variance. Right? It's basically x squared, or more generally, x minus a constant squared. And we call the constant alpha. Some real constant. Okay, so yeah, more generally, we have like x minus a constant squared. And what that looks like, the graph is just, it's a parabola. Okay, sorry, that's a pretty bad picture. Okay, the parabola like touches the x-axis at the point alpha. So this would be my function phi of x. And this function clearly satisfies all the requirements. Basically, there's only one of the c values in this case. This is both c1 and cn. So in this case, n is 1, capital N. And then c0 would be minus infinity, and cn plus 1, or c2 in our case, would be plus infinity. So there's only two intervals. And you see that there's like a red interval where the function is decreasing and its derivative is strictly negative, right? The derivative would be 2x, but since x is, 2 times x minus alpha. Since x is less than alpha in this interval, strictly, you see that this thing is strictly negative. And then there's a green interval here, where the function is strictly increasing, and the derivative is now strictly positive, because x is greater than alpha. Right? And obviously it's continuous everywhere. So you see that this is a function of, it's kind of a paradigm example of a function of this type. But yeah, without being overly formal about it, that's the type of function I'm going to look at. Now, obviously this is a little bit artificial, restricting to such functions, like, we could easily make this class of functions a bit more general and still get the same theorems to work, but we would have to work harder in the proofs. But I just want to convey the spirit of this theory. And this case is good enough for all of our purposes. Okay, so let's suppose we're just given a random variable. Call it x hat. With a CDF, f of x, capital F of x. Okay? And I'm not going to assume anything special about this x hat, just a random variable. Okay? What I want to define is a new random variable, y hat, which is phi of x hat. I want to say what it means for one random variable, y, to be some given function of another random variable, x hat, which is sort of known to me already in the sense that its CDF is known. What does this mean? So, in a way, it's a little bit presumptuous of me to call it y hat, because by using a hat over the y, it looks like I'm presupposing that this is indeed a random variable. Like, the hat notation over a letter is sort of my notation that I've been using all along to designate a random variable. So I don't mean to assert that y hat is a random variable. That's what we have to prove. We have to give it a meaning, first of all, and then prove that meaning does indeed correctly define a random variable. So actually, maybe I should just leave out the y-hat and just try to define this expression. And then not only should we define that expression, but we should also prove that that expression is always a random variable, given the way we defined it. And so I have to like choose the definition very carefully. What goes in this box here has to be chosen very carefully to make sure that we always do get a random variable. Okay? And that random variable can be called phi of x-hat. And then we can give it a name, y-hat, if we like. Because we know it is a random variable, we can rename it and give it its own sort of one-letter name. We can use the hat because we already know in advance that it is indeed a random variable. Okay? So the strategy for this is going to be to define its CDF. We're going to basically define phi of x as the unique random variable associated with a certain CDF, capital G of x, which I'm going to give a formula for. Like, I'll say exactly what capital G of x is, a complicated formula, which I'm going to show you where it comes from. But we have to check that capital G is indeed a CDF, like a valid CDF in the sense that it has the three key properties. Okay, only once we know that capital G has the three key properties can we call it a CDF. And then we know that every CDF is associated with a unique random variable, such that the two of them have the correct probabilistic relationship. And that random variable is going to be called phi of x hat, by definition. It's that unique random variable associated with or corresponding with this given CDF. And I have to say what this formula should be. Okay, let me just write down the formula, because you'll see that it's actually a very nasty formula, but it is what it is. Okay, so first I'm going to sum over all subscripts n such that y is in the range of phi sub n. Okay, yeah, this already, I've encountered a notation here that I haven't told you about. Okay, let me go back a couple of steps. You see these pieces of phi? I'm going to give them names. I'm going to call this first piece phi 1. That stops at c1. So what I mean by phi 1 is just the restriction of the original phi to the interval from c0, which is negative infinity, up to c1. So it's the same function, but its domain is restricted. And then phi 2 is going to be the function phi, but restricted to, so that its domain is interval from c1 to c2. And so on and so on. So this piece, this green piece here, is called phi 2. In other words, the green piece is the graph of phi 2. The green piece by itself is the full graph of phi 2. And then this next red piece is the full graph of phi 3. And this next green piece would be the full graph of phi 4, and so on. Okay, and then the last one is phi sub n plus 1. So here I have, phi 1. And again, it's the same formula. It's still x squared, but its domain is just everything from minus infinity to 0. Oh, sorry, to alpha. So I should have said x minus alpha squared. And then phi 2 would be the same formula, x minus alpha squared, but its domain would be everything from alpha to plus infinity. Okay, so I'm going to start by summing over all subscripts n such that... what is y? Okay. I want to use y as the variable. See, I'm going to reserve little x for the variable of this CDF, and then the new CDF, I'm going to kind of give it some variable, just so I don't confuse the two functions. The two functions really act on different inputs. So I'll call the input of big F, x, plain x, but I'll reserve y for the input of capital G. So yeah, you take all values of n such that y is in the range of phi sub n, and then I'll have to tell you what goes here. It's a big expression, but what I'm really saying, back in the picture, is that if I have a value of y on the y-axis, I can look at this horizontal line. Now you see it just so happens to pass through that cusp. That's just a coincidence. But, that can happen, so that's fine. So we look at this horizontal line through the value y, and notice that that y is in the range of phi 1, because phi 1 has a point at that height. It's also in the range of phi 2. It's also in the range of phi 3. It's not in the range of phi 4, because phi 4, its entire graph is below that blue line, so there's no point on that graph that has that height. Okay? And it's also, in the range of this piece at the very end point, and it's also in the range of this piece here, again, at that end point. So you see that certain phi sub n's do have y in its range, in their ranges, and certain other phi sub n's do not have y in their ranges. And we just want to sum over all subscripts n such that y is in the range of that corresponding piece. And notice, by the way, this is a finite sum. The sum is going to be a finite sum because there's only a finite number of pieces. There's n plus 1 of them or something like that, capital N plus 1. So these sums are finite. And that's really my reason for restricting this way. You might wonder, what about the sine curve? The sine curve can also be thought of as having these alternating... Oops, I did that backwards, didn't I? The sine function can be thought of as having alternating strictly increasing and strictly decreasing sections. But there's an infinite number of them. You would need to subdivide the real line into an infinite number of intervals. And there are certain technical problems with that, certain technical challenges, having to do with the fact that this will no longer be a finite sum. It will itself be a series. And then you have to worry about whether that series converges. That could be a difficult problem. So, for example, a sine function is not something we know we're going to be able to deal with on the basis of this present theory. Does that define a random variable? Well, it turns out the answer is yes. Indeed, you can take the sine of any random variable, and you do get another random variable, but it's beyond our technical capacity at this level to prove that. So something like x hat squared is perfectly fine for us, or cubed, or whatever, but more complicated functions that require an infinite number of those intervals, we can't really deal with. Let me correct myself. We could. It would just take a lot more kind of technical worrying about convergence that is just not worth doing right now for our limited purposes. Okay, now what's going to go in here is the following thing. We're going to take capital F, which was the original CDF, and we're going to take phi sub n inverse of y, and then subtract away from that f of c n minus 1. And this is the thing that applies in the case where phi n is strictly increasing, or in other words, its derivative is positive. But there's a different formula that applies in the other case, which is where phi n could have a strictly negative derivative. And that is going to look like this. It's going to be f of c n minus f upper minus of phi n inverse of y. And I'll just remind you that the upper minus is just a notation that I use for this, which really stands for the limit of f of y as y increases to x from below. So I like to put the minus sign as a superscript, because I find that it just makes the notation a little bit easier to work with. Okay, so you see that there are two cases. There's this case, I'll call the green pieces, which rise, and then there's this case where you have the falling pieces. So since those alternate, I could be a little cleaner and just say, this green case is kind of, let's say, all even values of n, and then the red case is all the odd values of n, but I don't want to be that specific, because I don't want to commit to the first interval being green or red. I want to allow that first interval to be either green or red. So it has to be understood that the green and red intervals, the ones where the function decreases or increases, are alternating. It's either going to be green, red, like that, or it's going to be red, green, red, green. But I don't want to commit to which of those is which. But anyway, for the green pieces, you're going to use this formula here, and for the red pieces, you're going to use this formula here. And then you have to sum up all of those. So you have to decide which formula to use for each interval, and then you're summing over all the intervals that happen to contain y in the range of phi n. You only use those n values where y belongs to that range. Any n value where y does not belong to that range is ignored. Okay, and if y doesn't belong to any of the ranges, then you'd be summing over the empty set. And the sum over the empty set is just considered zero. If I sum any function, any expression, over variables that are in the empty set. By definition, we set this to zero. It's called an empty sum. So you see, this g of y could be zero so far. The formula that I've written down could be zero simply because the y value might not be in any of those ranges. This y value might not fall into any of these ranges. For example, if the entire phi function has asymptotes, whatever looks like this, and y is up here, then the y is not in the range of any of the pieces, whether the falling pieces or the rising pieces. So yeah, in that case, you'd have a zero here because it would be an empty sum. Okay, now a couple other comments so far. Actually, the formula's not quite done. I have to add another term here. The other term is going to involve values of n for which y is greater than the range of phi n. And when I say that, what I mean is that y is greater than every element of this range. So, you know, the range, let's say I have a green piece, for instance, that looks like this. It's phi n. The range of that green piece would be these y values here. And let's say the actual value of y is there. So then in this picture, you see, we would say that y is greater than the full range, because it's greater than every value in the range. Okay. And what we add for all such subscripts n is f of cn minus f of cn minus 1. So that's the complete formula for g of y. But again, some comments are necessary here. For instance, I've used this expression phi sub n inverse of y. In fact, I used it twice. How do I know that those functions have inverses? Well, it's pretty obvious when you stop to think about it. Each one of those functions is either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing on its domain. And so it's every one of those functions is 1-to-1. Obviously, every strictly increasing function on the reals is 1-to-1, and every strictly decreasing function is also 1-to-1. So just a little note, that for every n, for all subscripts n, the function phi n, whether it happens to be strictly increasing one or strictly decreasing one, is definitely a 1-to-1 function, and so therefore phi n inverse exists. Okay, and that phi n inverse will also be increasing if the original phi n is increasing. So like in this top case, this function here is increasing. Let me symbolize that with an up arrow, actually double up arrow. My own notation is I like to use a single up arrow to mean like non-decreasing, and I use a double up arrow to mean strictly increasing, but that's just particular to me. I find those to be useful abbreviations. Okay. And then in the bottom case, this one here is going to be strictly decreasing, right? Because that's a relationship that is always true. If a function is strictly increasing, so is its inverse. And if it's strictly decreasing, then so is its inverse. Okay, and now there's other things that are true about those inverses as well, which are harder to prove and really like require calculus or multivariable calculus. But it turns out that because the derivatives are never zero on the interiors of the intervals, the inverse functions, they turn out to be differentiable too, except possibly at the endpoints. Okay. Oh, I should say, like, Let me just start it by saying, if I know that this derivative is strictly positive, let's say on the interior of the interval, does that imply strict increase? Yes, it does. It implies strict increase even at the endpoints. You can even conclude that it's like phi n is strictly increasing on even the closed interval. Okay, let me explain why how I know that. Little note here, just briefly in words. So we know that a positive derivative at a point implies local increasing, local strict increase, near that point. That's like standard calculus. If a function has a strictly positive derivative at a point, then there's a little interval around that point where the function is strictly increasing. So yeah, let me just draw you a picture. Let's say I have a point P, and I know that some function has a strictly positive derivative, meaning strictly positive slope. Okay, then the function doesn't have to coincide with that line, obviously, that's just a tangent line. But it does have to increase on at least some small interval around P. It's going to be strictly increasing. Now, that's true at every point. This is true on the entire interval, so it's true at each point of that entire interval. Okay? So if it's locally increasing near every single point of the interval, then it's certainly globally increasing on that entire interval. But what about at the endpoints? Okay, well, there continuity saves the day. Because remember that the function phi itself is continuous, so therefore each of those restrictions is also continuous. In particular, phi sub n is continuous. And continuity means that it approaches the correct value at the endpoints. So if the whole function is like strictly increasing interior to the interval, then you can just take the limit as you approach either endpoint. Okay, that should be a little more specific. Like, if I take some point x in the interior, okay, here's a question. Do I know this? Because if I do, then that will say that not only does the function phi increase when x is between cn minus 1 and cn, strictly between them and moving right, but it also is increasing even on this closed interval, because its value at this point is less than or equal to its values inside. But you know, how do I know if that's true? Okay, the answer is very, very easy. I can just look at this inequality, where y is some point inside, very close to cn minus 1. Since y and x are both in the interior now, and we know that the function is increasing in the interior, it's actually strictly increasing, so we get even a strict inequality. Then we just let y take a limit on both sides as y approaches cn minus 1 from above. And when you take limits of inequalities, you can only conclude less than or equal to. But in our case, it's okay to include less than, because you see that this thing is only going to decrease even more. The more y decreases, as y moves, in other words, towards cn minus 1, it's like decreasing, and then 5y is going to decrease with it. But anyway, I'll just say it sort of more weakly. Okay, now this term here, nothing depends on y, so you just get that. But then by continuity, this limit is just phi of cn minus 1. Okay, so yeah, indeed, this is a correct inequality, and so will that one be. So we can actually conclude that the strict increasing property is happening on the entire interval. Okay. Good, all right. Yeah, I guess I just should correct something. why are these less than or equal? Shouldn't they be strict? So I said strictly increasing. Okay, well, they are strict. Because, you see, if they were equal for some given x, let me just draw you a little picture. If I had some given x where the function's height was equal, then because the function phi is monotone in this interval, it's either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing, you'd have a contradiction. Because there would be a second value y where the heights are the same at x and y. And we know that can't happen. So that means the heights can't be the same at x and cn minus 1 either. Which means this really is a strict less than. Okay, so good. All right, and what was I saying before? Oh, I was also saying that in calculus, or really in multivariable calculus, is where you see a proof of this. But it turns out that as long as the derivative is not zero, which we know on the entire interior of the interval, let's say it's strictly positive, could also be strictly negative, it depends. Like whether we're looking at the increasing pieces or the decreasing pieces. But either way, what's going to follow is that the inverse function is also differentiable. Okay, and its derivative, let's say at y, is just given by 1 over the derivative of the original function at phi inverse of y. Okay, so this formula you've probably seen before in basic calculus. But the fact, the proof that this is really a differentiable function is something that you don't encounter until multivariable calculus. And if you're in my multivariable calculus course currently, then you will have seen this discussion. This was what we call the inverse function theorem, which we studied some time ago as an application of the implicit function theorem. So if you recognize that, that's a little reminder for you. If you haven't seen it, then just, you know, take it on faith. But the point is that these inverse functions are, in fact, differentiable in their domains, these inverse functions here, and therefore certainly continuous on their domains. Okay, so this is the formula for g of y. Everything at least makes sense mathematically, but the big question is why on earth would we want this gigantic unwieldy formula? Why would we want to consider that particular function? Where does it come from? And then there's another big question, which is, you know, is it really a CDF? It's not so obvious looking at this really ugly formula that this is a CDF at all. So let me start with that second question, just quickly check that this really is a CDF. And then I'll come back and show you where we got this from. Okay, so let's first ask ourselves, you know, does this give us really like a valid CDF? So there are basically four things to check. Okay, the four things are, first of all, this function obviously is defined in the reals, but to be a CDF, it also has to map into, and that's really the question, is does it map into the closed interval 0 to 1? When you look at this crazy formula here, it's not so clear that like it can't take a negative value. It's also not so clear that it can't take a value greater than 1, so we have to check that. All right. Second thing we have to check is that it's non-decreasing. Thirdly, it's right continuous. And fourth, it's exhaustive. Okay, and once we check all of those things, then we know that we'll conclude that capital G is a valid CDF, and so determines a random variable, y hat, which we can call phi of x hat. Okay, now why we would want to call it that, you know, why on earth would we want to call this crazy random variable phi of x hat? We have to answer that question separately, which we will do directly after finishing this check. Okay, well, why don't we do the easy ones first? Okay, actually, none of them are particularly hard, but it would be good to get a visual sense of what's going on. What does this formula G really look like? Okay, so let me show you. Let me just illustrate with 5 points. And of course, there's C0, which is minus infinity, and then C6, which is plus infinity at the two ends. Okay, and then let's just have a variety of different behaviors just to illustrate all the different things that could happen. Okay, for example, let's say I have a decreasing piece to start, which goes all the way up to plus infinity at this end. As we move indefinitely to the left, the function rises arbitrarily high. But reading left to right, it's a decreasing piece. Okay, then the next interval will have some finite range. The next interval will have some finite range. Bounded range is what I mean. Sorry, that got a little bit obscured. Okay, and then the last piece, I'm going to make an increasing piece. But this doesn't have to happen. The first and last could both be decreasing pieces, or the first and last could both be increasing, or they could be different. I'm going to illustrate the case now where they're different. So the last piece, I'll make like a green piece, increasing. But I'm going to make it a bit different in that it's going to have a horizontal asymptote. I'll just choose something arbitrarily. Okay, so let's say that I have a piece that's increasing, but asymptotic for that. All right? Now, let's say I pick like a particular y value, and I'll draw the horizontal line at that height. So I'll tell you how to visualize the crazy formula that I'd written down for g of y. And it goes like this. First, we're going to look at all the intervals where y is in the range of the corresponding function. And those are the following intervals. I'll highlight them in gray. So C0 to C1, because it has this point on the graph at height y. Then you have C1 to C2, which has that point on the graph. Then you have C2 to C3, because it has that point on the graph. Okay. The interval from C3 to C4 is of type 2. Let me highlight those in yellow. Okay, so type 1 is in gray. And then type 2 is in yellow. And what I mean by type 1 and type 2 is just that type 1 are the terms corresponding to this first summation sign here. And then the second summation sign I'm going to call type 2. Okay, so yeah, like the type 1 condition is that y is actually in the range. And then the type 2 condition is that y is completely above the range. So you see that happens here. In the type 1 case, it's the gray intervals, and this is another one, because of this point on the graph. This value y here, actually belongs to the range of that piece. But for the type 2 intervals, which includes also this one, y is completely above the range. Okay? Now, there actually is like a type 3 as well. Unfortunately, it's not in this picture. And the type 3 would be where y is completely below the range. Yeah, in fact, maybe I can even modify this picture to make that happen, just so that every possible behavior can be seen at least once. Okay? I can modify the picture in the following way. Let's say this rising piece goes up to here. So there's like a C6 right here. Then maybe there's another falling piece, but a very short one, kind of up to there, C7. And then from C7 onwards is another increasing piece that just is asymptotic to this line, has a horizontal asymptote. So C8 would be plus infinity. So you see that if you look at the interval from C6 to C7, let me label that one in green, in blue. This interval here from C6 to C7, we can call type 3. It has the property that y is fully below the range. See, the entire range of that little tiny red piece, the entire range of it, which is the heights that it achieves, is fully above y. So that's the condition there. The type 2 condition is the opposite. And the type 1 condition is that y actually belongs to that range. By the way, notice that these ranges are just intervals, closed intervals. Every one of these ranges is a closed interval. And that's because the domains of these pieces are closed intervals. And the properties of these functions, continuity, closed intervals, like continuous function always maps a closed interval to a closed interval. Because a closed interval is connected, and connectedness is preserved by continuous mappings. But connectedness means like being in one piece, or being all in one piece. Since a closed interval is a connected set, and in multi, you learn that the image of a connected set under a continuous function is connected. And then also you learn that the image of a compact set is compact. So the image set has to be a compact and connected set, and that is a closed interval automatically. So yeah, all these ranges are just closed intervals. I should make that comment.